everybody. I'd like to welcome you to the Strolling of the Heifer River Garden. This is a very special day for us. And the reason it's very special is many of you don't know this, but we had a tremendous amount of renovations done here. And it just literally, yesterday, was done. So it's been quite hectic. New floor, cooling, heating system that we've never had. It's all painted and clean. And there's also a lower level with handicap lift that goes down. If any of you would like a tour of the downstairs, we would be happy to give it to you. And we just recently moved down there. And downstairs is our new program that we're launching called Wyndham Grows. Some of you might have read about it. We're still waiting for a few more grants. The governor already awarded us $90,000. For 18 months, we need $300,000. But we're going to do it, and we're going to be very optimistic and keep our fingers crossed that the others will come through. You know, when there's a will, there's a way. And I think it will be very helpful for not only Wyndham County, but for the state of Vermont. It's going to attract new businesses, especially we are hoping to attract young people to come here and start businesses. And we already have quite a few in mind, but are always looking for more. If you have an idea or know of someone, we'd love to know them. The first year, we definitely are just taking businesses that are in Wyndham County. But after that, we are certainly interested in bringing other people from other areas to this area so that they will have their business in Vermont, anywhere in Vermont. So we're really looking forward to that. And I'd love to show you downstairs if any of you are interested. So there's a great program here tonight. Paul and Barbi are very generous to share their story. I still remember when they were on Main Street, when I used to go in and thought it was the neatest thing ever when I first moved to Vermont. And I'm very excited to hear the story. So without much ado, I'd like to introduce Shanta Crowley, who is the coordinator of the Slow Living Summit, who's worked tirelessly on this, and I think she's done an incredible job.
Thank you, everybody. I'm going to keep this very short, and that brings me to another reminder. That was my phone. So if you could do me a favor, make sure to put your phone on vibrate or silent or turn it off if you don't need anyone to try to reach you. So, we definitely have a couple of days of exciting things planned for you. Food and Ag Entrepreneurship, which at first blush doesn't sound exciting, but what we have done is certainly made it very interesting and to take you on a journey. So we have all sorts of things lined up for you, speakers to talk to you about how to match your mission with the money that you're trying to get into the door, individuals talking about how do you match the hero's journey with the entrepreneur's journey, and all sorts of unique ways of looking at how do you start a business, or if you have an entrepreneurial spirit and you work within an organization. So there's something for everyone. And also how taking care of yourself is taking care of business. And storytelling tomorrow night. But what I would like to do is introduce what we have, a great treat. We have Barbi and Paul Schulick. They are the founders of New Chapter. And they're going to talk to you tonight about how you navigate starting a business, navigating a marriage and family with all of that, and tying it all together. So I will turn things over to both Barbi and Paul, and I hope you all enjoy. And again, feel free to get refreshments, and we have restrooms right at the front of the room.
Thank you.
Hello. Stay away from that light there. Hi. Hi. Thank you for coming tonight. It's always special to be here. We were inspired by this opportunity because of the theme behind it, the slow living theme. That's something that in all our years of business, since the very, very beginning, has been core to us. We met as meditation teachers, and it's hard to, you know, I often say 30 years ago, I think it was 40 years ago. 30 suddenly became 40, who can relate? and that's what we thought we were going to do for a living, is teach meditation, and now you probably could. But in the 70s, I don't think so. So it became clear pretty quickly that we needed to do something else, but what developed was, because of our core commitment to exploring consciousness and truth, really kind of, I think, just a search for the self, right? And wholeness in life. That immediately kind of brought out the need and the desire to have a whole body, not just a whole inner life, but to really be thinking about what we're putting inside of us. And that led to an interest in natural products and helping others with that. So we thought that a kind of a cool way to start, because of that and because we could use it ourselves before we start, is to actually have a short meditation together that I will guide through. Those of you who have had meditation in your life won't find this terribly different. Those of you who have never tried it might find it intriguing. Those of you who have tried it and don't like it might find that it's okay just to sit for 2 minutes. And sitting for 2 minutes is meditation, so that might be a surprise. So before we do that, Paul was going to just inspire us with what we were inspired with around slow living, which is the slow living, I believe, parts of the mission statement that for us it was remarkable to read, because it was so like the new chapter mission statement and everything that we've tried to do in our company.
So it read like poetry, so whoever wrote it really was a master of the word. Slow embodies cooperation, respect, sustainability, gratitude, and resilience. Living should be mindful and purposeful, but also celebratory and filled with beauty, joy, and gratitude. When we live slow, we give back and become more strongly connected to the earth, to our communities, to our neighbors, and to ourselves. A slow life is one that seeks the right balance between spirituality, sensuality, introspection, and community. A slow life, by the way, this is only going to go on for another hour, hour and a half. You think I'm kidding? No, I'm just kidding. A slow life recognizes our role as members of our bioregions and of our earth, taking a nourishing rather than extractive approach, where we combine the wisdom of the past with a vision for the future to ensure a balanced, fulfilling way of life for all generations to come. We are all seeking a better way, a saner way, and a happier way to live and organize our lives. So thank you for bringing this all together, Orly and Shanta and others. Thank you.
Yeah. So if you're comfortable, just close your eyes. And to me, being slow, what real slow is finding the place inside that's slow. And that's what meditation helps us with, so that we can find the slow and bring the slow out. And when we just sit still, we notice that stillness is already there. Even if the mind is busy, even if the heart's beating quickly, even if some agitation is present, something there is still, something is slow. The space between each thought is slow. The pause between each breath is slow. The feeling of the ground under the feet. The pulse of the breath. And deeper still, the observer, that which is watching all the activity, is still and slow. And this very stillness is always there. Unchanging. So when we stop to meditate, all we're really doing is noticing what's active, and then noticing that below, within, and around that activity is a constant of stillness. And that's the slow. So when we remember to pause during the day, or in a moment of reactivity, we're giving us a chance to contact that place. Just take a few moments, a few seconds to come back. Thank you for indulging that, joining me. It's a good way to start out. So this is our story. For those who don't already know, you might have just dropped in thinking, oh, we'll try this out. Who are these people? We are founders of New Chapter, which is an herbal supplement company of probably 35 years. And this is our story. I think it's important to say that we've had many, many wonderful people working with us through the years, and many of them very, very important principals in the company. And each one has their own story. We all have our own story, right? And to each one of us, it's the story, which is interesting. If you put them all together, maybe you'll get the actual story. And Paul and I have kind of together developed a story. And, you know, we've told our story many, many times to many different audiences. And telling it here today gave us a wonderful opportunity to tell it from the point of view of slow living. We've never done that before. It was really, really exciting to incorporate that. You'll see these little yin-yang symbols showing up on certain slides, and that's a reminder to us of sharing the slide, or that there was something about our combined energies that created what we're talking about so true with our story. When we think about when the story started, we go really far back. And for us, each of us were deeply inspired by our fathers and each other's fathers. This is Paul's dad, and he's going to talk about him.
So that's not me, by the way. But that is my father, and that's about, oh, say, 1952, 53. So that's quite a while ago. And Dad was a pediatrician. And I, from my earliest memory, like so many of us, loved our father, and I went on my first house call when I was about 5 years old, and it was a extraordinary experience to travel with Dad, because those were the days when we would have the pediatrician would come to the home and relate with us and be with us, and Dad, I would say, is a classic example of the clash between slow and fast. In his lifetime, in the days of house calls, he would get up in the middle of the night often, and he'd go and visit the home. And that was a long time, and he'd be in the home, and when I'd go with him, it seemed like a long time that Dad was there. And one of the beautiful things about Dad was when I experienced it firsthand, when I wasn't feeling well, he'd look in my eyes, he'd look in my ears, I'd open my mouth, stick my tongue out, he'd listen to my pulse, he'd get my back, he'd listen to everything. He felt the patient, and that relationship is slow. It was the slow listening relationship with the individual. And in my case, also, Dad, as much as I loved him, Dad also represented fast. He represented the drug world and the pharmaceutical model. So I remember my first experience with modern pharmaceuticals. I took tetracycline, and I had an epiphany, and my father had an epiphany. My epiphany was I had severe gastrointestinal distress with one of Dad's first pills that he gave me, and later on, all of my teeth turned yellow. So I kind of had this initial bias against the pharmaceutical model. Dad also was, after that experience, was quite hesitant before he would then prescribe pharmaceuticals. And being a pediatrician, one of his first things was he'd be on the phone with the mother or the father or both, and he would always say to me, you know, it's kind of frustrating, Paul, after 7 years of medical school, that almost all the time, especially as a pediatrician, the kids are just getting better by themselves. I really just have to do almost nothing. And so, again, this is kind of the formation of New Chapter. This is like the philosophy that I was indoctrinated with. And it reminded me very much, as I give presentations, 50, 60 years later, of the writings of Paracelsus, who was the father of modern toxicology and actually was one of the first scientists to understand the relationship between mind and body, and believing that many diseases occur because of psychological states. And my dad would always say, you know, all I really have to do in most cases is hold the parents' hands, and the kids will just get better, and they get better faster. So what Paracelsus said, which is interesting, 500 years earlier, the art of healing comes from nature, not from the physician. Therefore, the physician must start from nature with an open mind. Now, let's jump ahead about 500 or 600 years, and we'll see the study that there was a Harvard study, Massachusetts General Hospital, the influence of patient-clinician relationship. So one of the first things I noticed when I'd go on house calls with Dad was the face of the parents would almost instantly turn from suffering to joy, just seeing Dad. Now, for those of us who are older than 40, you probably remember a house call and that feeling of connection and love from the community that you'd get from your doctor. And you can imagine what impact that would be. So when Paracelsus says that the doctor has to kind of step away and be an open mind, this study from Harvard would say something slightly different. Our results show that the beneficial effects of a good patient-clinician relationship, which, by the way, is defined as empathy, on healthcare outcomes are of similar magnitude to many well-established medical treatments. Among other things, it could affect weight loss, blood pressure, blood sugar, and lipid levels, and pain. In fact, the researchers noted that the impact was greater than the reported effects of low-dose aspirin or cholesterol-lowering statins for preventing a heart attack. So, the average time, I just read a study today, it's from the New York Times, the average time that an internist spends with a patient today, just take a stab, how long do you think it is? 2 minutes, that's pretty abbreviated. 8 minutes. My dad would spend 2 hours at times with a patient. And my dad would also often complain that there's a real issue as modern medicine turns fast. He said, you know, Paul, because I had my health food store, I can't do what you do in your health food store anymore, where you spend an hour or two with your customer. I can only spend 10 or 15 minutes. Now it's down to, 8 minutes. So the last piece actually I want to say about Dad, and this is pertinent to the formation of New Chapter, His dad was an atheist. Now, I loved Dad as much or more than I loved anybody else. But he had a very almost militant attitude because he said, how could there be a God if the kids could die? How could there be a God if there was a Holocaust? And God, and Dad was mad at God. So I grew up in that milieu, but I was also a child of the 60s. And so for me, I wanted to believe. I needed to believe. But I loved Dad so much, I needed some kind of stepping stone between this healer that was my father and this atheism, which I couldn't relate with. And to me, that stepping stone was the herbs. It was a sense that I was being cared for, that I could take the ginger or the cinnamon and I could be, my health could be uplifted. By the way, that's not poop on the chair, in case you were wondering. So that's ginger and cinnamon. So, Barbi?
And it will come into play in a little bit.
Oh, you have your clicker.
So, no, we only have one. We have to share the clicker. Yeah. So this is my dad, and that's us a few years ago. At the evening of the signing of our little health food store that we bought, which we'll also show you another picture of, my dad was an entrepreneur and a very passionate, hard-driving businessman in business with family. He started out with his twin brother, and then he went on to bring his brother-in-laws in to his plumbing supplies company. And so I grew up in an atmosphere where business and family were one thing. Passover Seders and company picnics, same people. And dining room tables covered with, you know, little pictures of plumbing supply, S-traps, etc. But really what came through for me was not only the work ethic, but the passion, the love, the intensity of the soul-to-soul connection, making relationship, and just the work being part of family and life, not separate, that it was all one thing, and that a person can just decide what they want to do and go do it. So that definitely was transmitted, I think, to myself as well as my siblings. And when Paul came along, Dad kind of approached him in the way that in The Graduate, the guy goes over to Dustin Hoffman and says, plastics, my son, my boy, right? Something like that. So it was plumbing supplies, my son. And here's this kind of hippie from the 60s who, you know, is interested in herbs, and he ends up in the factory of the plumbing supplies plant. And it didn't last very long.
6 months.
Yeah. But the beauty about my father was he was truly the mentor. He was truly wanted to do and help so that his kids could make the next step. And so he basically became our business mentor. And what we got from him, this is something that survived over the years, sanitary dash plumbing supplies. They were the only tubular brass. And so there was tremendous pride in not making a plastic S-trap, but it's a tubular brass. And so we know what quality means. And it was all about quality. It was all about service. And that stuck. That really stuck for us when it was our turn.
So the other father in my life, Gerald, he impacted me as a mentor in business. My father was not a particularly good businessman. He was a good doctor. But my father-in-law was a very, very good businessman, and he was a mentor. And as Barbi said, the emphasis on quality was very, very strong. And the emphasis on communication and customer relationships was exquisite. He was an amazing communicator with his customers. And he was a fabulous mentor. He suffered about one day of disappointment when I told him, Dad, you know, I don't think plumbing supplies is for me. And then I immediately was amazed at how quickly he said, what would you really love to do? What would really inspire you? And so I said, you know, Dad, I can't get out of a health food store. As soon as I go in a health food store, I just want to live there. I love it. I love those horrible smells. I just can't wait to make these uncooked soybean burgers and everything that I got used to doing. And I said, Dad, is there any way I could get in the health food business? And I don't know what inspired him to invest or to loan Barbi and me.
It wasn't the food.
It was, right. He was completely, he didn't eat anything even remotely close to health food. But from his love, which again is a theme of our communication and our business, is that we were loved by both of our fathers. And my father-in-law deeply loved me and embraced me. So he said, okay, what we'll do is I will invest, I'll loan you some money, Barbi and me will loan you some money, and we'll let you start a health food store. But I should say he gave me one very, very strong stricture. He said, I will loan you the money under one condition, that you don't change anything, and that everything that you do, you come back to me and make sure that any major change, because it was a going concern and it was going quite well. But in that process, Dad asked me, Gerald asked me, my father-in-law asked me, said, what is it about the foods and the herbs that draws you so much? So I'm going to take you through about a 5-minute course that gives you a frame of reference, because this is now 1978. I've been studying herbs for about, actually, since my junior year in college, about 5 years before, 73, was inspired by Back to Eden, Jethro Kloss. My dad had prescribed, I had severe digestive issues, like Crohn's disease, irritable bowel, all kinds of horrible things. And my dad's medications, you know, they were given with love, but they didn't work for me. They only made it worse. Whereas my herbs that I was using helped me feel better. So in that process, I started really understanding that the herbs would have a profound effect. And so when I ended up doing study of the herbs, things I realized in the process were very, very different than what I had expected and my father-in-law had expected. So it was this short story I'm going to take you through helps you understand this. So everybody, I imagine, knows what this vegetable is, right? It's broccoli. And broccoli represents the dark green vegetables that the Center for Disease Control and the U.S. government says we should have at least 5 servings of per day in order to maintain even a semblance of health. Well, it turns out only 14% of adults and 9.5% of adolescents in the United States have 5 servings of fruits and vegetables a day. In fact, the average American has about 3. So considering that fact, it's no wonder that the health condition is where it's at. But it gets even worse than that, which is, again, part of my inspiration for getting involved in health foods. Statistically reliable decreases in iron, calcium, phosphorus, riboflavin, ascorbic acid, and protein were discovered in foods studied by the United States Department of Agriculture between 1950 and 1999. So we all have our own version of a calling. We're called to do something, and I felt like, wow, I was starting to understand that the foods today are different than the foods that they were 50 years ago. And when you look at any one food, like broccoli, for example, look at what happened over a 55-year period of time. This is the amount of calcium that naturally occurs in broccoli when you eat it. So you'd have to eat 3 times more broccoli today than you did 50 years ago to get the same level of calcium. Now, magnify that by the fact you're only having 3 servings a day of fruits and vegetables. You've got a serious problem because the food's getting worse. And then to make the matters even worse, the worst food I could ever imagine, if you even want to call it a food, is French fries. Because you've basically stripped everything and you've put in a huge amount of polyunsaturated fats that are going to be real problematic for your cardiovascular system. Well, I looked at the statistics from 2009 to a period of about 20 years ago, 1989. The average serving of French fries went from 2.4 ounces, 210 calories. To the year 2009, it is now 6.9 ounces and 610 calories. The average American 40 years ago was eating 7 pounds of French fries per year. 40 years later, the average American's consuming 60 pounds of French fries per year. 60 pounds. Now, I don't eat any French fries, so someone's making up for my time. Cheeseburgers. I loved cheeseburgers in my day. But the cheeseburger that I had, it's been more than 20 years, but the cheeseburger that I had 30 or 40 years ago was about 330 calories. The cheeseburger of 2009 is 550 calories. So what you have, there's nothing inherently wrong with a cheeseburger, aside from the fact that it's factory farmed and God knows what's in it. But the real issue, minor issues. But the bottom line is we're eating the wrong foods, the disproportionate amounts of the right foods, and our balances are completely haywire. So for example, look at omega-6, the big red bar. Red omega-6 equals basically inflammation, which we all need. If you don't have inflammation, you can't heal wounds and you can't fight infections. So inflammation, contrary to many people's belief, is not bad. The omega-3 fights inflammation or counters inflammation. Scientists estimate or suggest that the ratio should be 1-to-1. The average American diet is 20-to-1. So essentially, we are on fire. We are aging much faster than we need to, and we have a system which is basically breaking down much faster than it needs to. And the essential calling to our business that Barbi and I went into, that my father-in-law was saying, what's going to move you? This is what moved us, was this calling. And that is what I believe was the major reason why New Chapter became successful, was because our passion to make a contribution was inherent with love in our mission statement. By the way, if that imbalance could be corrected, you're talking about close, this is another Harvard study, so I'm not talking about a New Age journal. Harvard said that if we correct that imbalance of 20-to-1, more to like 3-to-1 or 1-to-1, you could save up to 100,000 lives in the United States. So the imperative to make a contribution here is huge. And we felt that for the last 30 plus years. I'm going to tell you, this is going to take 1 minute to finish this part of the presentation. But what you'll see here is the percent of obesity, which correlates to diabetes and a number of other health conditions. This was charted around 24 years ago. And if you look here, the colors change. This color up here, I'm colorblind, by the way, so I don't even know what color it is, but it looks good. This one is purple, something like that, 15 to 19%. In 1985, you start seeing higher rates of obesity. 1987, you see the country basically becoming obese because of the style of the way that we have been feeding ourselves and the fact that also we haven't been exercising to the degree that we need to. This is the Center for Disease Control, by the way. And then you see new levels, 20 to 25%. Huge. In 1 year, look what happens. I don't know what happened in 1999, but that was a bad year. And now we've got another one, over 30%. So you're dealing with just an imbalance in terms of how the body can function. That's a meditation in itself, what we have been doing to ourselves. And I think that's the last year. No?
Okay. It's fast food, right? So this is our little health food store, 1979, with the bell bottoms on. And we were there about 7 years before we moved here to Vermont. And in that time, we discovered the development of herbal products. It was a wonderful start for us because we were our customers, the retailers. So we were experiencing firsthand what it was like for the people that we would soon be selling to. And we were able to see the gaps in the industry. We were right across the parking lot from one of those wonderful little family-owned pharmacies. And so when people came to Mother Earth, they often stopped at the pharmacy in the same errand. And we often got questions about what the difference was between the vitamins on our shelves and the vitamins on the pharmacy shelf. And it didn't take long for us to see that, yeah, sure, there were differences maybe in the base of the vitamin, but essentially they were the same, and ours were a lot more money. And we realized that there had to be something better. We were not avid vitamin takers. We were herbals. We liked taking herbals, and they really weren't that popular in those days. People took them more for problems, not so much for daily tonic value. And so this was a very, very important moment for us when we realized that there were gaps. And we were really interested in filling those gaps.
So a customer came in, I almost can remember the day when a customer came in with a bottle from the pharmacy, and she said, well, this vitamin C, 1,000 milligrams with rose hips, is the same, it says the same thing on the label as your vitamin C with rose hips, except the vitamin C that you're selling at Mother Earth is four times the price. Why is yours so much more expensive? And that was in 1979 that person asked the question. And remember, as Barbi said, I was more involved with herbs, especially because I had been noticing that people were taking vitamins. Usually in that time, that was the Linus Pauling days, and 10 grams and 15 grams and 10,000 IU of vitamin E was not unusual. And many, many of my customers were actually feeling more indigestion and weren't necessarily feeling better. And so when the woman came to me and she said, well, why would you charge me four times more? I didn't really have a good answer for her. I said, well, there's no artificial flavors or colors, but if you look deeper at the other labels, they didn't have it either. So I felt there was a real communication, a credibility gap, and I wasn't comfortable with that. And so when I was working with herbs, I noticed that the herbs would work. That if you look at the ginger and hold the cinnamon for a moment, it's a beautiful exercise. We put them on your chair for a reason. One is that our ancestors, our distant ancestors, believed very deeply. And this has actually been corroborated in science, where in certain cultures they have seen the way herbs were discovered was the shaman or the wise woman would put the herb on their chest at night before they would go to sleep. And then when they would dream or wake up in the morning, they would understand what the herb was given to them for. So what I like to do with cinnamon and ginger is the experience of them. If I ask anyone in this group pretty much what ginger is good for, or take a bite out of it, which I do, you know, many times a day, you immediately experience something which you have a personal experience with. And that experience is slow. And you're connecting yourself with the earth. That's why I love so much this notion of recognizing our role as members of our bioregions and of our earth, taking a nourishing rather than extractive approach. When you taste an herb like ginger, you're going to get all kinds of signals that go beyond your thinking mind. But if I was to ask you, sir, what is the number one benefit that you would get from chewing on ginger? Pleasure and taste, good. So that's the foremost. What do you what would you notice if you had an ailment? What ailment might ginger be one of the best herbs to take care of? Exactly. We just know it. But it was acquired for thousands of years, and hundreds of millions of people have had this experience. And the other herb that you can taste is cinnamon. And again, our ancestors would do that, and they would know what the cinnamon is good for. In the case of cinnamon, Cinnamon has now been researched as an herb incredibly beneficial for modulating blood sugar. So if you're dealing with obesity and blood sugar issues, cinnamon is one of the most valuable herbs that you can work with. So as in my store with Barbi, we noticed that more and more people were getting better using the herbs, but weren't necessarily getting a lot better using the vitamins. So, and by the way, the science on the herbs is also quite strong. If you take different extracts of ginger, they each are protective. But when you combine them together, you find a synergistic effect, which is the 1 + 1 is greater than 2. The whole is more than the sum of the parts. And that is the essence of herbal, true herbal medicine. Modern science tries to isolate and try to find out what makes ginger tick. And they isolate one constituent from the whole. But it's been our philosophy, and what has made New Chapters, one of the main things that's made New Chapters successful, is our fanatical attachment to that whole extract. Our competition is still selling just the supernatant, as an example. Or they're just selling their curcumin and turmeric. The most popular herb right now in the natural products industry is turmeric. And yet a lot of the products are just 95% curcumin. And there's about 1,000 chemistries in there. So the beauty of New Chapter, and we're going to take questions at the end, so hold that thought. I would love to hear it. But the whole idea here is that our philosophy was we started as an herbal company. I started writing books about herbs. But life had its own issues.
So a little surprise. So our fathers being the inspiration and my dad being our business mentor, things kind of came to a halt in 1982. We had a really kind of remarkable and dramatic experience of losing them both within a year of each other. They were the same age and they had the same disease, pancreatic cancer. So that it was really stunning and very formative for us, because what was already a passion became exemplified. Both of them were mostly interested in doing what the doctor said. My father tried more alternatives and was open to some. In Paul's father's case, he was really more married to whatever the doctor said to do. Did you want to add?
Yeah. So what Dad said to me, I said, Dad, you know, the doctors have given you 3 months left to live. And he had tried all of the measures. And I said, Dad, you know, we were in the Boston area, and I said I was near the Harvard Medical School library. So I said, Dad, I'll go to the library and give me a couple of weeks, and I'll come at you with some science that might help make you feel better or more comfortable. I can't promise you anything, but it might just make a difference, different than what the diagnosis you're getting right currently. So Dad said, okay, go do your research. And when you come back, if you can get my oncologist to bless it, I'll do it. So I set an hour appointment with the oncologist. You know how long? Talk about fast. You know how long that appointment lasted? It was 5 minutes. It was just like, or maybe it was 8 minutes. It was just like that study. The doctor said to me, he said, if there was anything of value, I would know about it. And what you need to do is you need to go home, hold your father's hand, and help him die. So that experience for me was so deep and so profound that it really was, I think, the turbocharge on a spiritual level that moved us and moved me to have the gravity that was able to, or the propulsion, I should say, that took New Chapter, because it was so obvious there was something wrong going on, that the doctor wasn't even willing to look at the research. Yeah. So, maybe I should take the clicker?
I think the next one's
okay, good. So the propulsion to me moved very deeply into meditation and to slow. And what you see here is a traditional Chinese healer. I don't know if there's an acupuncturist. I know there's going to be one who's going to be presenting a class. But the acupuncturist is reading the pulse, sensing this energy on a quiet level, has to listen very, very deeply to know what's going on in the patient. I should mention to you that my father, 2 weeks before his diagnosis with pancreatic cancer, went to his doctor, and the doctor said he was in a perfect state of health. About 2 weeks or a month before my father-in-law went to the doctor, he also was given a clean bill of health. So there was clearly, there was nothing wrong with the doctors, but the modern medical system, an acupuncturist might have felt there was something weak in the liver channel or something was awry. That's what these systems were able to intuit on another level. So it was that slow connection that I was deeply attracted to and that moved me to do more and more research in herbal medicine. And my teacher, Dr. John Christopher, in 1982, right around when my father was passing, I went to this course in Utah with the leading naturopath herbalist in the United States, Dr. John Christopher, and it was an immersion process, and it was profound. And it really indoctrinated me into what natural healing was capable of.
During those years, that was really the beginning of the products, because there were lessons and things that Paul had to do as part of his herbal studies. So most of the products, and I'm sure we have people here, entrepreneurs that are starting out in your own businesses, so often it starts in the home, in the kitchen sink, and in our case, it really, truly did. So things were being made at home, salves and herbal extracts and even herbal suppositories, which I once mistook for chocolate when I was very PMS one day, and they had cocoa butter in them, so I thought, oh, maybe. But no such luck. I ate about 10, though, before I figured it out. So, but that really was truly the start of New Chapter. These products we made in our, we refinished our garage to function as a kind of herbal laboratory and factory when we were still in Lexington. And we started selling these at our store. New Moon Extracts was the name of our company. And we started distributing all over New England at that time. So that was 1982. A lot of funny stories around that too, because we did the whole extraction process according to the moon cycles. So there were times where when the new moon hit and it was time to set the herbs and then to draw them off on the full moon, it might have been 3 a.m. when it was happening. And we gave into that process the beautiful stewardship of the herbs and following that tradition, which is also slow.
So the 29 plus days that it would take between setting the herbs and pressing the herbs was really it was a very deep process where you would align yourself with the rhythms of nature. And again, that whole concept of becoming one with the earth and feeling the vibrations, the scientist that my father infused in me, there's no way in the world you could prove, I think, that these extracts were any better because we waited for the moon cycles. But it was a really deep process for us of alignment, of getting our heads together when we would make the products. It reminded me a little bit of the Native American tradition where there was a whole ritual around smoking tobacco. Very, very, very different than our ritual today when we smoke tobacco. It was so in many ways, it was that type of ritual that really moved the production of these extracts. But as a business people, those of us who are entrepreneurs, this was our first expression. And like many first expressions, it was an utter failure. It met all kinds of resistance. And then I tried, again, another version. Again, the passion was very, very deep, or still is very, very deep. And the passion that realized that people weren't going to take these bitter extracts that had alcohol in them, I thought, well, maybe they'll take them in the form of concentrated powders. That also was a dismal failure. So one of my favorite quotations is from Winston Churchill. He said, success is not final. Failure is not fatal. It is the courage to continue that counts. So if anything Barbi and I had was courage. And so maybe it was blind courage, but yeah. It was courage. But what we did was I realized that people were willing to take vitamins, but they were unwilling to take herbs. This is, again, 1982 or 1985. So what ends up happening is I realize, okay, if I can stick some herbs in with the vitamins, maybe then people will start to take the product. But I wasn't comfortable giving people just regular vitamins because I saw what vitamins were doing to people. In many people, they were making their stomachs upset. So I had to find a way to give the herbs in a vitamin mineral form that would be acceptable to people. And I can't drink a glass of milk for the life of me anymore, or especially not back then, 25 or 30 years ago, but I could have a cup of yogurt. And why? Because the milk is fermented and it makes the milk easier to digest. So I figured if it does that for milk, why couldn't it do it for vitamins and minerals? And that was the birth of New Chapter. That was what finally became the success. That was what was accepted in the marketplace. Vitamins and minerals people would take, and then I was able to slip in these herbal extracts that I believe had a dramatic influence on their physiology. I'm yes. sorry?
They were fermented. Yeah, and they yes. still are. And it was a New Chapter. So it was in those days, everything on the shelves was USP vitamins, and it took probably 20 years to really establish the understanding that cultured nutrients, we call them life form nutrients, all kinds of ways of representing them, and now we just call them fermented, because people are understanding fermentation now. In the old days, that wasn't the case. But that was the paradigm shift, and it also made us realize that that is what we were interested in. We were interested in creating products that were kind of dramatic contributions to the channel. We didn't want to copy. And you know, copying's okay. Having a full line of supplements and creating something that other companies are creating, nothing wrong with that. But we weren't interested in Me Too products. We were really inspired by the New Chapters. And so we would go for a long time not having something in a certain category. An example is fish oil. We didn't get into the fish oil business till, I don't know, I guess it's maybe 6 or 7 years now, but we were out of that category for a very, very long time because we couldn't find anything that we felt was worthy of being called a New Chapter until we came across a supplier of pure wild Alaskan salmon oil in its pure form, and that's when we came out with our Homega product. So we were willing to forego the business to stay with the value of keeping it whole and making sure that it was a New Chapter. New Chapter also, this gave the company its name. We went from New Moon Extracts to New Chapter at that point, and the name also meant to us, obviously, wanting to offer people a new chapter in personal health, as well as making a contribution to healthcare in a broader scale. And now more than ever, we feel we have that opportunity. Many of you probably know that we sold the company four years ago, to Procter & Gamble. And we're seeing that this does bring an opportunity for much more expansion and touching more lives. For us, it's always been about reaching more lives with the product. I would have been happy to stay a small company. But the notion of kind of keeping something that really works, that really makes a difference in people's health in a small sector, just didn't seem right. So it felt right to move to a larger platform. So the vitamin product gave birth to what we call our 10 principles of formulation. And these have been upheld for all these years. And I see our friend Liz in the back there, who was a big help to us. She was on our board for many years, Liz Bankowski. And there was a point at which I realized that Paul was holding these formulation principles in his mind. It was something he did every day, and it was something he upheld for every product that he created. But it was something that nobody else really completely understood. He was a one-man show for a very, very long time. And I realized that as we grew, it would behoove us to create a codification of these formulation principles. I remember very clearly Liz and I sitting down with him and actually forcing the information out of him and taking notes, and then we filled them and everything else. And now we have a rather large and exciting innovation team, and they've all been schooled in the formulation principles, and folks at P&G are being schooled. So they've withheld the test of time, and I've learned how important it is to write things down. And the other beauty of them is they force slowness. In watching a process of innovating a product at New Chapter, the impatient amongst us would find it very challenging, because these formulation principles expect slowness. They expect if you're going to make a contribution, it might take quite a while, like in the fish oil example, to actually come out with the product. Other things you want to say?
That's great. So you have 80 products that we've created plus a New Chapter, and every single one of the 80 products has gone through this hurdle. Every single one of them. So whereas some models will have a good, better, best, you know, you have to supply the market with this and make the customer happy with this, our philosophy and my philosophy was always, let's just give them what I want to take. Only make the best. And I'm always just made the product for myself and my family and my friends. And from that love is just the category that New Chapter would hold. And so each one of the principles of formulation, bringing light, which means to bring healing, make a contribution. I worked in a health food store for 10 years. I knew that we didn't need another vitamin C product, or didn't need another echinacea product. At that time, there was 10 echinacea products. New Chapter could have made a lot of money had it sold another echinacea product, but why would I do that if there were already them on the shelf? Because I was a retailer, I knew, do no harm, back to tetracycline. Herbs or even high doses of vitamins, you don't really want to go there, because you can still cause an imbalance in the body. Acknowledging tradition, thousands of years, you can't throw that out. Science, my dad, the history of science, the 50, 60 years of modern science and understanding what makes so much of our even modern herbal medicine work. Using common sense, extracts that were made when we started innovating certain types of herbal extracts. The extracts very commonly were being extracted with acetone and hexane, nail polish remover and dry cleaning fluid. So to me, that was not acceptable. It was not common sense that you'd want to take an extract that was extracted with those compounds. 1 + 1 = 2. That's probably of all of the principles, it's the one that sets New Chapter aside more than any other, because that's the ginger story. There may be something in ginger, or there may be something in turmeric that makes it work really, really well. But I don't really think I understand what makes turmeric work. There's 1,000 chemistries in turmeric. I don't know why they're there, but I believe that there's an inherent wisdom, what we refer to as the wisdom of nature. Being open. Remember Paracelsus? He said the first thing that a physician should do is be open. Was the oncologist that served my father, was he open? No. Be light. So when somebody comes around and says, I've got a better herb for that, or I've got a better way to deliver that herb, I'm going to listen to that. Being light, you have to walk the walk. So whatever your business, whatever you're doing, you walk the walk. People can sense that you're not authentic or that you're cutting corners. And I think that's the one thing. When I walk into a store now, 35 years later, or I give a presentation like this, the one thing people can't argue with is that I believe in what I'm doing. And I'm doing my best to walk the walk. And being light is mean you express the vision of what you're attempting to do. So, and also being light means taking yourself lightly and understanding that there's a lot to be learned. and that when people are delivering an herbal product, if they're all stressed out delivering the herbal product, it was like one of my teachers used to say, if you sit down to a bowl of broccoli and are having a fight with your wife, it's going to do a lot worse for you than if you sit down to a McDonald's hamburger and having that same meal. You're going to be a lot worse with the bowl of broccoli. So being light is a really core principle, and part of what Barbi and I really strove to present at New Chapter was an environment where people could be light, where people could care for each other and love each other. That was a really key piece for us and part of what made New Chapter. And then our belief was, if you do all of these 9 steps, then the last step will happen, that you will prosper. And for, in the case of New Chapter, it has proven to be true. New Chapter has prospered.
So there came a point when the 4 walls of the health food store didn't hold Paul down anymore. I think you can probably see why. And we decided that it was time to get out of retail and to put everything into the manufacturing and distributing of the products. When I look back at that, I realize what an extraordinary move that was. It wasn't, you know how you do things when you're young and you don't necessarily think about it much, but our business, our livelihood was in the store, and the manufacturing, the New Chapter products were very nascent, just starting out. But we chose Vermont, probably for the reasons that so many of you here have chosen Vermont. And when I look back again at that, I realize that the values in Vermont became the values in the bottle, became the values of the company. And I bet that's the same for many here. Sustainability, nature, community, entrepreneurialism, progressive thinking. That was who we were, and we felt for sure we belonged here. And the love of nature. The funny thing is, we thought moving here would slow things down. Right? Wasn't that a great find when you're looking for this? Like, ooh, that was an exciting one. But, I mean, I'm sure most people can relate. It wasn't slow. It was fast. It was survival. It was everything we could do to keep our heads above water. The meditation practice continued. I think the big difference in the slow was being in nature. You know, having that opportunity to just go outside and connect and seeing deer on your property. That was a big change for us. We've had many spots in Brattleboro. We started out in our house, which was completely crazy. We had 3 employees when we started in 86, and within 3 years, there were 10 people coming to work every day or driving up the 600 feet driveway and the tractor trailers delivering herbs and everything else in the middle of the winter. And then we moved downtown. We were on 99 Main Street, which Burroughs is now. And we opened up what I think Orly was remembering was the Natural Apothecary. We created a storefront there. Really wonderful, wonderful place where people could come and get quick massages and nurse their babies and pick up their herbal products at the same time. Made absolutely no money. But New Chapter was behind it. We had our offices behind it. And we had our factory downstairs, I think, where the bike shop is now. And then we moved to 22 High Street, right up there, right across, right near the little mall there, connected to the Brooks House. And we had a couple of floors there over the years, a lot of people that are still at New Chapter remember those days. And then we moved to Technology Drive off of Putney Road, which is where we are now. So this one I loved because it mostly represents, I thought it represented Paul, who was always ready to take the risk and jump off the cliff. Then I realized that, no, I jumped off the cliff too, but I was the one in the helmet. If he was in this picture, he wouldn't have had a helmet on. So that tells you something about us. And I also realized that you need the balance, right? You need the balance. Both we have needed that balance in our marriage, and we've needed that balance in our business. We've been married partners and business partners all along the way. And that completion is really, I think, a lot of the time what stopped Paul from self-destructing and stopped me from doing nothing. We study the Enneagram at New Chapter, and if you're familiar with it, it's a really beautiful, ancient, the hare and the tortoise I added in. But this little diagram is the diagram of the personality types of the Enneagram. It's a beautiful Sufi system, very old, but it's very popular now. And It teaches the different areas that we fall into early in our lives as we're trying to survive our family structures in childhood. And once you know your type, it starts to really make a lot of sense, how you became that way, the forces behind it, but also that it's not really you, that there's somebody else in there who is more pure and whole. And we use it to understand each other in team building and et cetera. So Paul and I went through the system, and we found out that he was a 7 and I'm a 9. And a 7 is an epicure, an adventurer, and a cliff jumper, and restless, and always needing change, and always looking for the next thing. And I met quite a few entrepreneurs that are 7s. And a 9 is a mediator. 9 is the harmony maker, the grounded force. There are also other referenced people. They're not self-referenced people. They're the people that are making sure everybody's got the fork and the knife and the potatoes on the plate. And then it makes me think of my grandmother sitting on the side on the step stool while everybody's eating. So that's us. And that's Paul, the hare running ahead and the tortoise keeping up. But the fact that we've both been there together all along, I think, had a lot to do with how we ended up doing okay. I wanted to share a few systems that I use for staying slow and also for understanding fast and be ready for both of them. This is just a graphic of the I Ching, which is one of the oldest books on the planet. It might be the oldest. It was the guide for Confucius and for Lao Tzu. So it gave rise to the Tao Te Ching, etc. And it's a system of 64 hexagrams, and each hexagram represents a different aspect of the changes of life. The I Ching means the book of changes. And it's said to be an oracle, which at first when you start using it, you're kind of, But after using it for a while, you really see the extraordinary wisdom in the book. There's actually I Ching apps now. Talk about slow becoming fast. But what I've learned from it is that life is structured in a system of almost predictable changes, if you really look at it, much like the seasons. So when you run into a time when there's stagnancy, maybe a feeling of incubation, and it might give rise to feelings of confusion and impatience, it's actually just like a fog over the mountain. That's all it is. It's just a damp day, you know? And it might be a damp week. But it's nothing to fight, and that's what the I Ching teaches, is that those are the times, those are the given slow times. And there's a lot happening in there. It's like a seed in the ground. And if we give into it, if we remember, then when the fast times come, we're nurtured for that. The I Ching gives many, many, many more slow reminders than fast reminders. And I take that as a very, very serious lesson about life. So many times I've checked the I Ching when I'm ready to go into that meeting and say such and such or send an email or, you know, make a choice, especially in a business environment, in a corporate environment now, that could have far-reaching effects. And if I listen to it, it will slow me down, and almost always it's right. And then there are these extraordinary moments when the message is pushing upward or go, do it now, 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 it's beneficial or whatever. And whether you listen to it as a timely, you know, kind of oracle, or just reading the book, what you really, really get is to go with those changes, to allow the slow and allow the fast. We also follow the same practices when we practice Tai Chi. It's the exact same system. And in doing Tai Chi, you learn to push and you learn to yield. And you see that they're both necessary. They can't be a push without a yield. And also, much like the I Ching, the instruction is a lot more slowing than pushing is necessary to really become martial at Tai Chi, which is ultimately the purpose for it. You have to really, really culture the slowness in yourself to connect with the Qi, which is the energetic force that is then used to make impact in the world. Again, some powerful lessons.
So back to the business world, 1989, we hit one of a number of walls that most small businesses hit, and we were about to go bankrupt. One of our major distributors defaulted on a payment. And it was one of a half a dozen experiences like that. And there, at crossroads, you scramble, you have the tenacity, the passion, or whatever it is, or the, and also often the luck. And we were able to pick up at that point partners in our business that were willing to invest in the business. And but we ended up selling about half of our business in 1989 just to keep going. And to those of you in the business world, that will not sound too unfamiliar, because there's always those hidden events. And then there's the other events that occur in business, like you make choices that we were doing about $4 million in sales in 1999. And around that point, we had built an infrastructure, great products, and it was really, really hard. That first $1 million, I'll never forget how hard it was to get there. It was excruciatingly challenging just to open up the accounts and develop the reputation. And I remember with our vitamins and herbs, we would, our biggest customers were always the store people, but they didn't want to sell the product because they said, well, if I sell your vitamins, it's going to invalidate everything else. So it was frustrating, and it took about 17 years to build up that structure, at which point I was able to invite and attract key partners that had a set of skills that I didn't, or Barbi didn't really have. One of them is Tom Newmark, who is a brilliant litigator and a very, very creative force. And Tommy, along with me, brought in one of the most creative and exciting and charismatic sales leaders in our whole industry, Herb Lewis. And between Tommy, Herb, and myself, we called ourselves the Spice Boys. And we basically ramped up the young. It was young on whatever. It was severe young energy. I thought I was young. But when I started working with Tommy and Herb, it was like crazy. After 3 or 4 years, young in me started turning to yin. And I became the brakes. I started saying, I don't think we can make that many products. And so it became a whole different kind of dynamic of where you see in relationship, I'm the hare and Barbie's the tortoise. Well, I became the tortoise. And it was an incredible, humbling experience to witness that process. But at the root, we were still that same passion-filled organization, and the infrastructure was there. But it was that structure that brought us, I'd say, to the heights that we have achieved.
So during that time, I had the choice of joining this Yangi exciting team. My husband tripled. Perhaps doing something different. And it was a crossroads for me, because I felt that bringing my energies in with these energies right at this time wasn't necessarily what the company needed. The breaks weren't what we needed. And I wasn't wanting to go on that ride right then. I think I personally needed a break. But when I look back now, I see that everything that I did during those years was preparing me for what would happen when I came back. So what I did was I retreated. I spent a lot of time on my spiritual practice. I went back to writing. I'm a writer. I wrote a book during that time called Ethel Katz Finds Her Guru. And I taught. And I just found those spaces in myself. I spent more time with my kids. And it was about 5 years. And I was still, you know, a source of advisory to Paul. But it was a good thing. When I came back, it was with the same kind of impulse and energy. Time to go back. It's really needed now. And a lot had to do with where Paul was, because he was going through that period of, you know, some imbalance himself. And so I felt it's time to go. And when I went back, I saw that the growth years, which again are necessary and intense, but changing the culture in a way that I felt needed now to be brought back a little bit. I saw that we were starting to put sustainability on the back burner, and that we weren't thinking about people's careers, and we weren't teaching leadership. We were just pushing. We were just growing. We were just doing what we had to do to survive. And it was time for a little bit more of that balance. Another piece of slow in New Chapter is our farm in Costa Rica, or what was our farm and is still our partner farm, called Luna Hueva. In 94, Paul went over there to establish a growing facility, a farm that we could rely on for organic ginger, because we were really getting into the ginger product sector. We're actually one of the first to create it. And we happened upon Stephen Farrell, who's an extraordinary talented biodynamic farmer, and he still works at the farm, he still runs the farm. And over the years, Tom Newmark developed the farm into an eco center, a learning center for biodynamics, and it's now an eco lodge. But what this became for New Chapter was a place where anyone associated with the business could go to slow down. Our employees are gifted after 3 years with a week-long or five-day trip there, and we've always brought customers and retailers and used it as that opportunity.
Well, and then what I guess every entrepreneur kind of dreams about is that there's the big break. And we had created a foundation for the big break, for something really superlative to happen. We had cultured a wonderful relationship with Dr. Andrew Weil, became a close friend of ours, and we had traveled a lot with him, and I had lectured to his integrative clinics, and he became really connected with our mission and really loved many of our products and was particularly interested and valued our number one herbal formulation called Zyflamen. It's 10 herbs, and the purpose of the formulation is to help modulate a healthy inflammation response. And the big break occurred as we were building momentum in the business. Andy, who is and was the one of the great leaders of the integrative medical field, he was on one of a number of trips on the Larry King show. And Larry asked, it was like a layup for New Chapter. Larry asked Andy, "Is Andy, what do you do in your clinic when someone comes to you with inflammation?" And Andy said, "Oh, it's simple," something to this effect. He said, "I recommend this product called Zyflamen." And Larry said, "What did you say? Could you repeat that, please?" So, you know, this is $1 million a minute kind of advertising. So Larry said, "Could you please repeat that?" Yes, Andy said, "Yes, it's Zyflamen." And to make matters even more, you can imagine the adrenaline flushing through my partner's nervous systems at this point. And then Larry says, "Could you please spell that, Andy?" So on national TV to 10 million people, Andy Weil says, "Okay, Larry, it's Zyflamend." Literally the next day or week, we had $1 million plus in sales of Zyflamen. And you have to remember, it's a great product, so it's not just that $1 million. People keep coming back, and it builds the momentum for the future of the line. So that was one of the big, what every entrepreneur kind of dreams about happening, and it happened. And I still kind of have these fluctuating dreams of that happening again. But it was an amazing moment in our history, and it is part, enter the clicker, it is part of what I believe was the culmination in the purchase of New Chapter. After 1989 to 2010, we had about 30 years of business, or 25 years of business. Many of my partners that I had invited in the business, they said, "This is great. New Chapter is at a peak, and now's the time to get a return on our investment." Now, I did my best to argue with them. Liz is shaking her head. She knows I did try my best, and with Barbi, to say, we don't need to sell our company. We're only going to get bigger and better, and please, I want to continue the path. But the partners had every right to want to do this, and we ended up going through a suitor process. We had many, many suitors, and amazingly enough, in all candor, our favorite suitor, and was one that I least expected, was Procter & Gamble. Because what they did is they brought many of their top executives, and they sat around the table with us, and they were the most interested in Barbi and me, in our mission. because they had investigated 17 other companies in our sector over a period of 2 or 3 years, and they said, you know, they're all kind of selling the same stuff. It's all the same vitamins. It's all the same herbs. But what this company, New Chapter, has is a mission. It's different. And so a couple of the key leaders of Procter & Gamble said, we'll invest in this company. And what this picture represents, every day Procter & Gamble touches 3 billion people around the world. 3 billion people. At its peak, New Chapter has touched about 800,000 people, which is great. We did about $100 million at our, when Procter & Gamble came to our tables, about $100 million in sales. Now, to an $80 or $100 billion company, that's a rounding error. But for a small entrepreneurial venture, $100 million is a great achievement. But it is the opportunity to touch the billions of lives and the quality commitment and the intensity with which they were prepared to further our mission is what encouraged Barbi and I to stay involved in over the last 4 or 5 years, to continue this vision of what is yet hopefully to come.
So what's been a surprise to me is how important a founder's role can become after the sale of a company. I never really thought of founder really mattering that much. And as you're building your company, you're not walking around thinking, I'm the founder, I'm the founder, I'm the founder. You're just working. You know, you're running the office, you're doing what you have to do. But suddenly, founder becomes very important. And it becomes important because joining two cultures is very, very challenging. And certainly a corporate culture with a mission-driven culture has been extraordinarily challenging. And the values that began the company stand to be lost in a situation like that. So a lot of the reason that we felt it was imperative that we stay, and many of the days are hard, but we felt that it was really, really important for the good of this little tree, this little sapling that grew into this tree, and for the people that have nurtured our company and so many of the people that we work with and care deeply about, is just to be there, to steward those values, to watch out for what's in the bottle, and making sure that what's in the bottle stays what's in the bottle. And what is the culture? Who are we really as a culture? Well, we're non-GMO, we're organic, we're a B Corp. And becoming a B Corp, surprisingly enough, happened after the P&G merger. So that tells you something. It's very easy to be skeptical about that possibility, but they're standing behind non-GMO, they're standing behind the organic mission, which says to me that there's opportunity to change a corporate system from the inside. That was the most compelling prospect to us, was to be within a system with that kind of influence and be able to sit at that adult table and make choices that could change the way healthcare is looked at for all of us.
I should also mention they have 1,000 PhDs in their research and development division. So the access to that kind of science and product development is a dream come true for a formulation team.
So these are our guiding principles that we've engraved in wood, so they never change. They're sitting in our reception area. They're also on the box top. And these are the principles we may have to make sure stay with us. Just reflecting on what a mission-driven company is, and I think we've touched upon it. To me, the most important thing is authenticity. When we look at a brand and we ask what that brand is about, without even knowing it, that brand is emitting who the people are. It's infused with the people behind it. And if a company is grounded in pure intention and authentic, true hopes and values, it comes across. So that's for me the thing that I take home, is that always has to be remembered. The other is kind of a no-no in business, is love. And I've thought of a lot of different words for love when I'm writing things, but it always comes down to love. It always comes down to loving your product, loving the mission, loving the people that you're working with, loving your customer, all different forms of love. We've never been one who thinks of business as separate from life. I don't think of anything as separate from life. Life's life. So if I love people at home, I'm going to love people at work, and that's all there is to it. Something that happens a lot at New Chapter that's always happened, and happened with P&G, happened with all of our investors, and every time a banker came that we were begging for money, the conversation would get taken, kind of go off course from the financial and the spreadsheets, et cetera, very, very quickly into the conversation about what they should take. The main concern was, okay, these were amazing, these supplements you just told us about. I have to have some now. Which are the right ones for me? And there'd be these little things in the corner with Paul and pieces of paper, and people would just grab him, I mean literally, to find out what they should take. And then they'd go home with pockets full of products. And then a week later, just throughout the next week, would be 25 emails about what every member of their family should take, and can you just send a little of this, and can you send a little of that, and it's quite something. It's and that, but that's it. That's a mission-driven company. That's what happens when you have that much passion for what you're doing. It's contagious. It spills over. We're all connected that way. This is our company credo. I'm not going to spend too much time on it because we're running along here. Paul has already mentioned passion and tenacity. We wrote this as a unit at New Chapter. Over 100 people contributed, and it's much, much longer than this. This is just a little tip of it. But again, writing down who you are really matters. It can be lost, and writing it down helps you remember what you are. You are what you are, but you need to have some kind of touching stone. Open communication became a very, very important one to us, as did balance and rejuvenation, because those were some areas that during the growth years, there wasn't that much attention put on. There was a lot of burnout. So I kind of embraced balance and rejuvenation and open communication as something that I could bring into the company with more fervor, with more commitment. And so we started a very, very lively and in-depth leadership development program in which we learned to talk to each other. We use nonviolent communication as a model, which is an extraordinary one, and really exemplifies the beauty of slow, of pausing, of having to slow down to really consider what you're observing in somebody, what assumptions you're holding, to slow down enough to feel the feelings that are running through you, and to acknowledge the needs that you're having, and to slow down enough to be able to make requests. And there's not enough time to go into it, but it's really an amazing model to use in a business, because now we have people, instead of saying, why are you micromanaging me? Instead saying, when you stand in the doorway just like that and I'm on the computer, it makes me nervous because I have a need to develop this program myself, and I know you care, but can we talk about maybe another way to go about our relationship? And that just opens the door. And then the other person gets to say, well, I'm standing in the doorway because I have a need to know that such and such and such and such. It really helps. It helps in those reactive moments. It sounds kind of funny in the beginning, but it works. So we work a lot on giving each other feedback, learning how to receive feedback, one of the hardest things to do, and coaching each other as well. And taking those pauses, taking those moments. So Paul and I thought about how to end. And the thing, besides, you know, it might seem like we just want to show you our family album. This is our kids, Jeremy and Rosie. But they represent for us the next generation of entrepreneurs. Instead of coming into business at New Chapter, they chose to expand their artistic careers as entrepreneurs. Jeremy's a musician, and this is his piece. He's a classical guitarist in a duo called 350. He composed this, and it's called Touch the Ground. And Rosie's an artist of many, many expressions, and one of them is illustrations of cards that she calls Rosie's Wonders Connection Cards. And her cards have beautiful messages that are very apropos of the entrepreneurial journey. So we thought it would be a lovely way to end with our blessings. So let this be a meditation too. Be yourself.
Great stuff, thank you. and I have a comment and two questions. The comment is, Ben & Jerry's, of course, is owned by Unilever. Ben & Jerry's was one of the first B Corps. Unilever, now the parent company, is investigating B Corporature, if I can coin a word, which would be by far the largest undertaking. So if they do it, maybe Procter & Gamble will learn from you and from them how to scale it up. Yeah. My questions have to do with the Procter & Gamble buyout. Number one, what are you doing in the company right now? And number two, what assurances have you built into the buy-sell that the integrity of what you've done will continue once you do step down?
Two great questions. What we are doing now is actually very similar. What is your first name?
Shell.
Talking on Impossible as a Dare on Saturday at 1:00.
Oh, sweet. Okay, very good. So what we are doing now is actually really similar to what we've always done at New Chapter. Barbi has always upheld the spirit, the culture of the company, and I continue to be a key member of the innovation team, and both Barbi and I stand on the executive lead team of the company, and we meet every week amongst the leaders of the company, and we express ourselves. We also are meeting with leaders in Cincinnati, and we have communication on a regular basis with the voices there. And what's interesting is one of the biggest tells, I think, Shell, of that relationship was that Barbi and I have been to Cincinnati now twice. Actually, I've been there quite a few more times than that, but we were invited to two town halls at Procter & Gamble. And it, they have a large room, few hundred people attend the session. And we gave pretty much a similar presentation as you're seeing tonight. And no one told us what we can and can't say. So there was a huge amount of freedom and the expression about non-GMO, about organic, and the commitment to B Corp and the higher principles. So they have remained committed to that for the last 4+ years. As far as into the buy-sell agreement, they own New Chapter. So it's their the buy-sell agreement is really a commitment to our mission. There's a clear appreciation of the mission of New Chapter that was from the very beginning that they met us. They have said that that's why they invested in the company, was for that mission. But there's nothing that's in writing that actually says that they have to follow our mission statement.
What I'd add, though, is it's the way that they have, especially now working very closely with the individual who's the president of Global Healthcare, and he championed the acquisition. It's the level of interest and concern and welcoming and need that he has to connect with us and other legacy leaders at New Chapter. There's a tremendous openness there and a desire to continue the values of the company and do right by it. And it's been a tough journey. It's been a very, but you know, for us, it's the whole thing's been a tough journey. So I think that people don't always realize that is raising any company is tough, and there's been so many chapters, so many points along the way that were challenging. So this is challenging, and that was challenging, and it's all about just having the courage to keep going forward. But we feel particularly good about that individual and working closely with him, and he's the guy running the show.
And what you see over and what you see growing, actually, Shell, is a sense of commitment to the core principles of New Chapter. It's taken time for a number of the people were skeptical about fermentation, or they were skeptical about some of the aspects of why would you spend 10 times more for an herbal extract, for example, of grapeseed. We spend $250 a kilo for our grapeseed extract. I could buy grapeseed extract today on the market for $30 or $40 a kilo. Why would you want to do that? We would explain that to our partners at P&G, and we would show them, well, here, for example, there's at least two two studies that are double-blind, placebo-controlled studies that show that this grapeseed extract at $250 a kilo is going to perform. Well, what's interesting is when we did a little bit more study, we found that that $30 a kilo extract was actually, as Rutgers researchers found, was that the product was actually adulterated, and that the extract was actually at least of 21 samples, according to Rutgers researchers, 42% of them were adulterated with peanut skin. And six of them, of the 21, that's all they were was peanut skin. So one of the beautiful things about our partnership with Procter & Gamble is, as I mentioned earlier, that 1,000 PhDs, they've got all of the technology. There's 1,600 brands, Shell, in the natural products industry currently. Of those 1,600 brands, a lot of them don't deserve to be in the health food store. Because if I'm going in and I believe that grapeseed is going to help my cardiovascular system, I don't want peanut skin when I take that product. And so the beautiful thing for me as a formulator is knowing that that dedication is very, very deep. And one of the things that Barbi and I particularly have had to work with, is people's skepticism that a world's largest consumer goods company really cares. I can tell you, they really do care. And they really do represent that kind of quality. That's, up until today, that has been my wonderful relationship and New Chapter's partnership with them. Does that answer your question?
We actually have more trouble with them putting more energy into the quality in some cases with testing and et cetera, that it's their adherence to quality is really fierce. So that's one thing I think, you know, years and years and years from now, if we're not around, that I don't think we'd have to worry about the quality of the product.
Yes, sir.
My name's Eric. I lead Slow Money Vermont. It seems like there are a couple points in this story where access to capital was really key for the business to continue and to grow. There were a couple of early products or approaches to product that seemed like they didn't fly.
Yes.
You kind of moved to the point of reaching a new chapter and then later on entering the growth phase. Mm-hmm. I'd just be curious in anything you'd be willing to share about sort of how you kind of managed to access the capital or may have managed your cash flow at those times to make sure you got to the next.
Have you ever tried begging before? Sometimes it got to that, Eric. I remember, I'll just tell you a fun story. One of our early adventures, we had invested very heavily in a product for amelioration of environmental toxins. And we had done two clinical studies showing that it was efficacious. And it was really, we had invested all of our dollars in it, virtually all plus more. We had discovered about 3 months into the process that we were losing $100,000 a month. And we only had $100,000 in the bank. So we were really at that edge. So sometimes, I think Liz has used the expression that there's angels sometimes over an entrepreneurial business. There's little angels that fly over a company like New Chapter. When your intention is pure, and our intention for sure was pure, and a key investor came from one of the builders of Amway, was witness to our science, and he said if even 10% of what you're claiming to be true about that product comes true, you've really got about $1 billion business just in that one product alone. So at that point, we were up here on the 99 Main at 22 High Street, and we really couldn't afford even office furniture at that point. And so what we decided was he was coming to visit New Chapter. So what we did was we rented a rug over here at Candle in the Night. We asked him, can we borrow a rug so we can look like we've got an office? And we set tables around, we set these chairs around this table, and we literally, like overnight, built an office where we could host this multi-billion-dollar enterprise, so we didn't look completely fly by night. And it was that kind of tenacity and cleverness, I think, that allowed us to survive. I think it was also there really was a genuine sense that our products were what we said they were. And the access to capital also came a lot from the like Tom Newmark, for example, one of my early and most valuable partners. What he did was he used his last savings himself to invest in New Chapter, and Herb Lewis also did that. They invested their own capital, which they had very little of, to actually do it. So a lot
and many of the investors also were friends and family through the years that, especially when we were starting to grow more, people actually wanted to invest. So, but we had quite a few investors. We had over 100, 125.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yes.
Yeah. Going way back when you still had your store, but you were still well on your way to developing your products, you said that some of the retailers that you were selling to posed the question, if we sell your products, it's going to invalidate everything else.
Oh, good, thank you. What's your name?
Skylar.
Skylar?
Skylar.
Skylar? Yes. So the retailers were selling, say, the vitamin C product, the vitamin C in Rosehips, 1,000 milligrams with Rosehips. They would be selling that product, and then I would say, I've got a vitamin C that is 100 milligrams of vitamin C, but it's going to be three times more expensive than the vitamin C that you're selling. And my vitamin C has been cultured, it's been fermented. And after I'd convinced them that vitamin C was more natural, more in the form of food, cultured, and told them the whole story, they said, oh, I'll try it. But when they try it, some of them would feel better and really like it. But when it actually came down to actually selling our product, they had already had $10,000 worth of what was represented by the ascorbic acid plus Rosehips. And they could, on some level, but they'd have to really get behind my product in order to compete with the other product. But it took, after, if you look at the industry trends over a period of about 15 to 20 years, what ended up happening was the industry started following our model of Whole Foods, and that's what the consumer really was interested in. 30 years ago, I'd go and give a lecture to a group of people like this, and I'd say, where do you think your vitamin C comes from when you're buying it in a health food store? And they would say, well, I think it's coming from extracts of grapefruits and oranges. And it really wasn't. It was coming from ascorbic acid. But what I would tell them, that what we're doing is we're culturing that ascorbic acid, and then we're also culturing it in Whole Foods. That was a much more appealing story to our industry. And right there was the core of what made New Chapter grow. That story that I just told you in 30 seconds is, I said, here, you have a choice at Mother Earth. I'll give you vitamin C in its purified, isolated form, in the form of ascorbic acid, or I'll give you vitamin C in the form of a cultured form where you have been culturing it with a group of other whole foods. This is more expensive. It's, in my judgment, it's more natural. This one is more potent, and it's much less expensive. Which would you like? I'm not disparaging the ascorbic acid. I'm not saying it's bad for you. It's quite good for you. But it's a different story when you're selling in a health food store the vitamin C in a more wholesome form. And that's really what differentiated our New Chapter products. Does that make it clear? Yes.
Hi. John Stephen Bianucci with Iroquois Valley Farms.
John?
John Stephen.
Yes, thanks for meeting
you. That was really inspiring. I wanted to give you a stand.
Thank you very much.
A stand corrected. My question is, are you researching what the effect on the beneficial microbes in the gut are from your herbs?
That is a really, really great question. That is the field of our whole field is the fastest growing segment in the natural products industry is actually the probiotic field. And we are avidly working at developing and creating products in that arena. I've done a lot of study on fermentation. I wrote a book called The Life Bridge. And in the book, John, I elaborate. You're welcome. If you send me your card, I'll send you a copy of my book. Because in the book, I describe that through eating fermented foods, more and more research is demonstrating that you are cultivating your own bacterial environment. You probably already know this, but for some of you who don't, 9 out of the 10 cells in your body that you call you is actually bacterial. So it's a very humbling experience. I'm not mostly Paul Schulick, I'm mostly bacteria. And so whatever you eat, whatever you take in your body is actually having a profound effect on that intestinal flora. And so when you eat tempeh or you eat natto or you eat sauerkraut or you eat those foods, you're profoundly affecting your intestinal flora. Now let me give you, I think Barbi would appreciate this particularly. One thing that we all need to be more mindful of is there's early studies which showed that you could go on a different diet and it could take a number of months to alter that intestinal flora, which is the most biologically active system of your body. However, if you go through just 3 days of severe anger or fear stress, you will have an impact that's comparable to 9 months of a dietary change. So that's why it's so important to keep in mind the mind-body relationship that Paracelsus made so famous 500 plus years ago, and Galen hundreds of years before that. So yes, Procter & Gamble has been studying our ferment metabolites, our media. We're looking at things like our beta-glucans, that are a key part of potentially helping immune function. And we are really avidly working at creating our next new chapter in the field of probiotics. I'd say we're about a year away from that new chapter, and we expect that there will be a lot of clinical research to support it. I just want to say, if I was to suggest a single supplement that could make a huge difference for so many people, in addition to the Zyflamend and so many of the other products, is to make that shift in the fermentation area, to eat more fermented foods like tempeh and miso. You'll notice in kombucha and kefir, those kinds of foods will make a dramatic difference in your quality of life.
They're really easy to make at home, too.
And they are very easy to make at home. Thank you so much. Yes?
Nick McKinnon.
Nick, nice to meet you.
Green Mountain Farm. So does a biodynamic crop or a specialized crop in a certain region play a more important role in the product that you're using and the effects that it comes from that?
That's a great question, Eric. Our farm that we bought in 1994, Luna Nueva, is a biodynamic farm. And I was profoundly attracted to the science of, or the art, I should say, of biodynamic farming. What was interesting was sometimes I say there's an 11th principle of formulation, and that's being practical. For years, we were selling organic turmeric extract in our turmeric forest, and we didn't declare it on the label. And the reason why we didn't declare it on the label was I was a little bit intuitive. I kind of had a sense, it happens every so often, where I said, well, what happens if we can't get organic anymore? And I don't want to stop selling turmeric if I can't get organic turmeric. I'll still supercritically extract it like no one else was in the very beginning, and I'll still use water and alcohol and not use the acetone and hexane. But we basically were the largest purchaser of organic turmeric in the world at one point, and we bought out the entire supply. And so we were not able to buy anymore. And sometimes we're already in a market, and we're actually looking at this, Eric. It's a really great, timely question, because we're looking at actually creating a line of products. Our products are already much more expensive than most of our competition. And to achieve the next level, if we're to do all biodynamic or all organic, we're going to have to charge yet even more. As you can see, we're certified organic 70%+. But to get to 100% and to reach biodynamic status, very few people would be able to afford our product. But that's a level that actually, between us, turn the camera off, this is an area that we are heavily investing in, is going to a yet higher level that will be basically unheard of in our industry.
I guess that was where my second question was going. Do you think that, you know, like you said, it's not really practical for a large population, but here in Vermont, it possibly is?
Yeah.
How do we move that?
Well, I think we would create a signature line where we could provide a certain level for those people who will invest in that. And P&G, being perhaps one of the largest banks in the world, they will invest. When they see there's a market for it, they will invest in it. So if we can show them in small test areas that we have an interest in that kind of quality product, which I personally would like to take, then they will, it's my understanding, that they're open to investing in it. Yeah. Any other questions?
I was just going to ask, is we've always joked that Paul thinks he's the average consumer, but he's anything but. But I think that's why we were always on the edge, because he was always dreaming, he was always looking, he was always wanting more, he was always seeing into the future. Yeah.
So thank you so much for
thank
coming.
You. A real pleasure.